Mr. Tarrou, today we're going to be doing a relatively long problem. And certainly you can see a lot of notes up here, which is not normal for my pre-calc. We're going to solve some higher order equations, those equations that don't have just exponents of 1 and 2, but exponents of maybe 3 and 4. So the example we're going to eventually do has a degree of 3. But first, there's a lot of steps that you need to take to solve higher order equations without the aid of a graphing calculator or computer. We'll cheat a little bit on this Descartes rule and just get a little tip on how to start these though. First thing we want to do is we're going to look at an equation, which I don't have any room to put up here on the board right now, but and we're going to identify, well, hey, the highest exponent is bigger than 2. So how do you solve that? Well, the first thing is going to be put it in general form. Get all those exponents to count down by 1 with the highest degree first. In my case, it'll be an exponent of 3 on this example, and the constant out at the end. And you want to list all the possible rational zeros. Now, this is called the rational zero theorem in your textbook. And what you do is you look at the constant, you break down all the factors of the constant. That's the number at the end of the equation with no variable next to it. And you take factors of the leading coefficient, that's the number in front of the term with the highest exponent. And you start making a list of possible rational zeros. Remember, rational is a fraction like 7 over 2 or 5 over 2, which is 5. But rational is not imaginary, and rational is not numbers like square root of 7. It's a fraction. And don't forget to put a plus or minus. So you can end up with a long list of possible zeros right off the bat of the problem. And that is where the time-consuming factor of this section comes from if you're not helping using a graphing calculator to aid with your solutions. And by the way, this material was really relevant before graphing calculators. Nowadays, we can find solutions of any degree problem very, very easily with the aid of a graphing calculator. Descartes' rule. This is a rule to help you figure out if you're solving these questions purely with no graphing calculator and it is all going to be trial and error with these possible rational zeros, then the Descartes rule is going to help you limit the number of guess and checks that you have to do with synthetic division. When you look at an original equation, the number of sign changes or that number reduced by multiples of 2 is going to be the number of possible zeros, positive real zeros, that the equation has. So if you look through your equation and you notice that there's 4 sign changes going from negative to positive and positive back to negative and so on, if you notice there's 4 sign changes, then there's going to be a possible of 4, 2, or 0 positive real solutions. Then you're going to take your equation and plug in negative x and resimplify, kind of like you're checking for even an odd function. If you plug in negative x into your equation and resimplify and look for your sign changes again, the number of negative real zeros equals the number of sign changes, or again, that number reduced by 2. So if you plug in negative x, you simplify your equation and you have only one sign change, then you know that you only have one negative real solution. That's where the graph crosses the x-axis. Then you want to hopefully this Descartes rule will limit the number of guessing and checking you have to do, and you start doing synthetic division over and over and over again until you find you have a remainder of 0. If you do synthetic division and have a remainder of 0, that is a place. If you do synthetic division with 3 and you get a remainder of 0, well then that graph is crossing the x-axis at 3 or whatever number you did synthetic division with. Remember, with synthetic division, you are dividing by the form of x minus c. And so you're synthetically dividing by a binomial with a degree of 1. So if your original equation has a degree of 3, and you do synthetic division, and you find a 0 remainder, then what's left on the bottom of your synthetic division will not be a third degree like you started with, but a second degree. And that would be nice because we can solve second degree equations. If remaining factor, that's the number at the bottom of the synthetic division, the new polynomial, if the remaining factor has a degree greater than 2, well then you're going to have to keep doing synthetic division to try and eventually find another number that gives a remainder of zero, another x-intercept, which then eventually, one by one, you'll bring those degrees down until you get a degree of two. And once you break it down to a degree of two, then you can finish that with quadratic or using some factoring to finish solving the equation. Well, that's a lot of words, but how do you actually apply it to a problem? We're only going to have time to do one example in this video. I will be doing other examples, though, just I know I'm going to run out of time for this one. Okay, so our equation of interest here that we want to solve is f of x equals x cubed minus 3x squared minus 13x plus 15. Okay, well, our leading coefficient is 1, and that's pretty easy. Factors of 1, well, you only have one choice. And factors of the constant at the end of the equation is 15. Well, we have 1, 3, 5, and 15. So I'm going to make a list of all my possible rational zeros. So my step one possible rational zeros are plus or minus 1 over 1, 3 over 1, 5 over 1, and 15 over 1. Now, if my leading coefficient was 2, and it was 1 and 2, then it would be 1 over 1 and 1 over 2, 3 over 1 and 3 over 2, 5 over 1 and 5 over 2, and then 5 over 1 and 5 over 15. Again, that would be if the leading coefficient is 2. You need all the factors of 15 to be paired up over all of the factors of your leading coefficient. Of course, mine is 1, so I've got a relatively short list, but look, in my relatively short list, I still have a possibility of guessing and checking 8 times. I'm not going to do all that guessing and checking on the video because I never finished with the example. Okay, what does Descartes' rule say? Descartes' rule says to look at the original f of x and look at the sign changes. Well, I go from positive to negative, so that's one sign change. I stay negative, and I go back to positive. So there's two sign changes. Well, that means that there's either 2 or 0 positive answers, positive real solutions. Okay, what about f of negative x? Well, that's going to be negative x to the third power minus 3 times negative x to the second power minus 13 times negative x plus 15. So that's going to be negative x cubed minus 3x squared plus 13x plus 15. Now look at what we got. We've got negative to negative to positive to positive. So there's only one sign change here, which means we have one negative real solution. That means that, you know, maybe I want to just do synthetic division with the negative numbers, the negative 1, negative 3, negative 5, and negative 15, because as soon as I find 1, I know I've found the only one, and I can throw out all the negative numbers that are left in that list if I had to do more synthetic division. And that would really cut down the amount of times I have to do trial and error with my synthetic division looking for a remainder of zero. Now, of course, with graphing calculators as an aid, we don't really have to do a lot of guessing and checking. And plus, for time, I'm just going to say that I know the first number that works is going to be negative 3. So let's do synthetic division with negative 3. I'm just going to be really lucky and get the right number to do synthetic division by and start doing step number 3 where I said do all this trial and error, or maybe your teacher's going to go ahead and let you figure out what the first or second solution is so you can do synthetic division until you get down to the second degree and just finish it with quadratic or factoring if they're trying to hopefully save you a little busy work in your homework. So we're going to synthetically divide by negative 3 And our factors here are our numbers when we do synthetic division. And if your exponents need to count down by one, if there's a missing exponent, don't forget to fill it in with zero. So I got 1, negative 3, negative 13, and 15. And don't forget with synthetic division, the second line is addition, and the last line, when you get to that last line, you're multiplying. So we're going to bring down the 1 with addition. 1 plus 0 is 1. And then multiply through the bottom. Negative 3 times 1 is negative 3. And then add. Negative 3 and negative 3 is negative 6. And then multiply, we get 18. Negative 13 and 18 is 5. And multiply. And negative 3 times 5 is negative 15. And voila, we have a remainder of 0. Again, this remainder of 0 means that 3, or negative 3, is a solution, or an x-intercept. That's what solution, root, and zeros are. They're x-intercepts. So this graph, this third degree polynomial, is crossing the x-axis at negative 3. Okay, so now how do you finish it? Well, we had a third degree. Synthetic division, again, is dividing in the form of x minus c, x to the first degree, which means that this is 1x squared minus 6x minus 5. And again, it's equaling 0, not because of that remainder, but because we're finding solutions to the higher order equation. Those are x-intercepts. That's when y equals 0. And now, this is a second degree. I'm going to solve this with factoring here in a second. If it was the third degree, I would have to set up synthetic division again and check another rational zero until I got it down to the second degree. So in other words, if this started off as a fourth degree, this would be a third degree, and we'd have to do synthetic division again and again and again until we got to a degree of 2. Well, now we have a degree of 2. This one will factor. It becomes x minus 5. Ooh, no it doesn't. That's a plus. Made a sign error. And x minus 1. And then the solutions are going to be 5 and 1. Or, a lot of times with these problems, because we're getting kind of advanced in math, they're not going to give you ones that factor easily, so you might have to do the quadratic formula, which is net x equals negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac. Whoops. A is 1 and c is 5. All over 2 times a. And when you finish with this, this is going to be 6 plus or minus. This is 36 plus minus 20 over 2. And 36 minus 20 is 16. So it's going to be 6 plus or minus 16, square root of 16 over 2. That is 6 plus 4 over 2 and 6 minus 4 over 2. And we're going to get the answers we just saw a second ago. And that was 5 and 1. And the other solution came up from the synthetic division. And that other solution was negative 3. So the three places where this polynomial is crossing the x-axis is negative 3, 5, and 1. You can check that with your graphing calculator. Woo! I got one question done. Kind of long.